There, I think we got this puppy rolling here. It's a Monday morning. This is Up North News Radio. I'm Pat Wrightlow. It's a Monday morning, kind of rainy in many parts. It is October 23rd, and I was just calling up the radar here, and oh yeah, pretty much the western two-thirds of the state, not looking terribly dry right now, but nice to have you along. Thanks for joining us. The radio show will get started at 6:06, right after news and commercials. We will talk about how a Packer loss stings a bit more on rainy mornings like this. We'll have some uplifting news about the Badger football team, not so great news about the Badger volleyball team. We'll talk to Kristen Lyerly for a bit about headlines and weather, a little bit more on sports. Then our second hour, we've got our friends from Motherhood for Good coming in, along with State Senator Kelda Roys. And we'll talk about how Governor Tony Evers provided a reprieve to childcare providers and parents by saving the Child Care Accounts program, but only the legislature can fund it to a sustainable level, and they still seem rather hostile to that idea. All of that, plus Terry Bell has three things you should know to start the week. That's all coming up just about 4 minutes away. right, let's light this candle.
Across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Brightlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's Monday, October 23rd. It's another beautiful day to have you here up north from wherever you're listening across the Civic Media Radio Network or on the Civic Media app or by podcast or social media. Here in the state of Wisconsin Sense, where we're going to unpack the news for you in just a little bit. Here's what's on tap this morning. Well, you know, the early morning rain just seems to sting a little bit more on Mondays, especially when the Packers lose. But we will turn to our Monday morning guest and Chief Morale Officer, Kristen Lyerly, to lift our spirits a bit as we recap some of the weekend's headlines and scores. You know, some weren't great, like the Packers and the Badger volleyball team. Others, like the Badger football team, did a lot better. Hockey teams as well. In our second hour, we're going to talk about how a reprieve is not a resolution. Governor Evers gave that reprieve to child care providers and parents by temporarily saving the Child Care Counts program. But only the legislature can fund it to a sustainable level, and they still seem rather hostile to the idea. So we'll talk to our friends from Motherhood for Good, along with State Senator Kelda Roys. And Civic Media News Director Terry Bell will have three things you should know to start the week. We'll talk to Selena Heller, one of our reporters here at Up North News. We'll get the weatherology forecast from meteorologist Jennifer Fuchitsky coming up. And along the way, if you'd like to join us, we'll take your phone calls at 844-967-2789. Again, that's 844-967-2789. You can email the show, radio at upnorthnewswi.com. And if you're watching on one of the Facebook pages where we appear, you can leave comments there and we may put them up on screen and respond to them. We are on the pages of Up North News, of course, also Civic Media and the Tap FM, our home in Chippewa Falls, and Bull Falls Radio in Wausau. You can also catch us on YouTube if you search for Up North News WI. Temperatures around Wisconsin to get the day started. And again, it's a rainy one so far for the western two-thirds of the state. But everybody's going to get wet here at some point, at least a little bit, it seems. Here on Lake Wissota, it's 47 degrees. Madison is 45. Waukesha, 41 degrees. La Crosse, 47. In Wausau, it's 40 degrees right now. In Wisconsin Rapids, it's 43. Green Bay reporting 44 degrees. And Hayward is at 45. And again, wet and a little bit warmer today, tomorrow, just a little bit. And then there's a real cool down coming by the end of the week, and we're going to get more than a little bit of precipitation along the way as well. But unfortunately, that precipitation is too little too late to do us much good, you know, for the growing season. And we've already had the impact on fall colors, though it was a beautiful drive. We'll see if Sam did any driving as well. Sam Davison standing by down at the Civic Media Control Center there in Madison. Sam, how are you? How was your weekend?
I'm good. My weekend was also pretty good. I did a lot of fall and Halloween sort of things.
Halloween sort of things like buying candy or...
No, I was stocked up on candy already.
I meant buying the candy that you ate from the first batch of candy, or is it still sitting around?
It's still sitting around, so we're stocked up for
that's
now.
That's amazing restraint. Or did you just buy things you don't like? Are you giving the kids black licorice or something like that?
I'm just trying to make it last. I don't want to spend too much on candy.
Okay, I understand. What else did you do? Just errand running, you say?
Went to a pumpkin patch. Went to go see the Rocky Horror Picture Show, which was pretty fun. Mm-hmm. Made some squash soup.
That's squash soup?
Yeah. It was pretty tasty.
Wow. That was very creative. All right. We did a lot of driving around, and I don't know if it's still down by you, but, you know, we didn't get like the burst of all kinds of fall colors. Things were, you know, very yellow this year because of, you know, temperature and all that. But I mean, it was really yellow yesterday. A lot of yellow, a lot of rust out there. I was driving through the Knapp Hill area of western Wisconsin. And that's, you know, it was There was some beautiful driving times over the weekend here. Still looks pretty good. I hope down that way too.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The leaves are great. Mm-hmm. It's very pretty.
Oh, and let's see, we start a new lineup today, if I'm not mistaken. A couple of different things are going to happen this week. We're going to start new shows. Well, yeah, different kinds of shows today. And then we're actually going to start what's called a new clock, I think, on Wednesday. So you might notice our commercial times change and that, you know, Pat has the prattle on for a little bit longer than usual in some instances here. But correct me if I'm wrong, Sam, but I believe that we have Todd Alba moving to noon to 2 today, correct?
I believe that's correct, yeah.
And then he goes noon to 2, and then where's my notes? I'll tell you what. It's
Earl is on after you, I believe, right?
That's right. Earl comes on pretty much almost statewide, except for the Madison area and maybe another spot. But yeah, Earl Ingram's on at 8. And then you've got As Goes Wisconsin coming on after that till noon. Todd Alba is noon to 2. Matt Flynn now from 2 to 4. And the Devil's Advocates are from 4 to 6. So, again, that's the lineup changes this afternoon, where it's Todd Alba, noon to 2, Matt Flynn, 2 to 4, Devil's Advocates from 4 to 6. I believe this followed by Maggie Dawn. And, well, Terry Bell will be on later, and since he's the news director, he's supposed to be the smartest guy in the building. So he'll know all this stuff, right?
Yeah, he's like this wizard. He's a wise old man. I shouldn't call him old. He's not that old.
No. It's okay. It works. He was working at Channel 13 before me, so I'm gonna consider that he's the old man for this one. And yeah, again, he'll get a chance for rebuttal coming up in just a bit. Let's take a break here, and then when we come back, we'll talk all about the various sports scores and highlights and lowlights from the weekend, and unpack some of the news as well. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this Monday morning, when you're here, you're up north. Nice to have you here. We'll be back. Could not get Matt Flynn's name out of my mouth. I had Matt Kelly in there or something like oh. No.
I've never listened to his show. I don't think I've ever met him either.
Yeah, he had done the mornings here for quite a while, and then a year ago just basically up and said, I don't want to do it anymore. So that's how I ended up here.
Did this show exist before then?
Yeah, it was 8 to 11 originally. Uh-huh. And so if we hadn't moved, we'd have been 8 to 10, which was rather humane. But this'll do. Oh boy. Are we going to do this? Are we going to do the rainy days and Mondays thing? Just real low key start to the week here.
Talking to myself and feeling.
No, let's not do this. Sam, kill the record. Thank you. Appreciate that very much. It does feel a little like a rainy day on Monday when the Packers lose the way that they did. Now, again, I'm not going to get all worked up about every loss. That's going to happen. It's a new quarterback. It's a new era. So it's not so much the losses. It's occasionally the mistakes or just the little frustrations. To me, there was just a lot of little dip and doinks from Jordan Love. It's like he did not realize he could throw downfield, or it's that, and I don't see the whole field, it's that our receivers have just not been that great this year at getting separation. Whatever the case may be, it was a whole lot of short yardage. The defense was giving up far too much yardage to the Denver Broncos and ended up losing. Packers lose to Denver 19-17. The Broncos were scuffling as well. It just was not a pretty game to watch. The write-up here says that Love is frustrated by the offensive inefficiency. So is Coach Matt LaFleur. Well, hell, so are the fans. We're a little frustrated as well. The defense held Russell Wilson and the Broncos largely in check and rallied to take a 17-16 lead midway through the fourth quarter. But again, there just wasn't any kind of rhythm on offense, especially early. The Packers have now been outscored in the first half of the last four games, 63-6. What'd he say? He said, in the first half of the last four games, the Packers have been outscored 63-6. And here's another case in point that people are frustrated about. Love had running back A.J. Dillon open on the left side for what would have been a big gain on third and 20. But Love looked too deeply this time and tried to heave it, and it was picked off by the Denver's safety. And it was just lots of little things like that, make it sound like, we're a bunch of unhappy fans, and we are temporarily, but I would again say, this is going to happen from time to time this year. Don't be setting the bar too high. If you want to set the bar high, do it game to game, and you have to do that next Sunday because the Packers' next opponent, it's a division game, and they're playing the Minnesota Vikings at noon next Sunday at Lambeau Field, which will probably be a chilly, I don't know, maybe a wet Lambeau Field, so it's not going to be great conditions for the game anyway. But the Packers are going to have to step that up. Much better news for the Badger football team. I wish I had seen this. I was out of town for the weekend, but heard all about this comeback win that Braden Locke threw a 3-yard touchdown pass to offensive lineman Nolan Rucci with 27 seconds left on Saturday to cap an 18-point fourth quarter explosion by Wisconsin that gave the Badgers a 25-21 win on the road in Illinois. Locke was 21 of 41, passed for 240 yards and two touchdowns in his first start since taking over for the injured Tanner Mordecai. The Big Ten's leading rusher, Braylon Allen, ran for 145 yards for the Badger football team, now 5-2 on the season. The Badger women's volleyball team received an unfortunate setback, but again, a match that was immediately hailed as an instant classic, a thrilling back and forth, and ended in heartbreaking fashion, a 5-set loss at Nebraska. Nebraska taking that match 3-2, so it's almost certain that Nebraska will take over as the top seeded team in the nation with an 18-0 mark, and the Badger women's team drops to 18-1 on the season. They have several days off now. They will be at Michigan State this coming Friday evening. The Badger women's hockey team will still be ranked number one in the nation, most certainly, after sweeping Bemidji State on Friday and Saturday. The Badger women's hockey team is now 8-0. They will be in St. Paul this coming weekend for matches Friday and Saturday versus St. Thomas. The Badger men's hockey team is 5-1 on the season after sweeping 17th-ranked Michigan Tech on Friday and Saturday. That 5-1 start for the Badger men's hockey team is the team's best start since 2004-2005. And now the men's team will open up Big Ten play against the Minnesota Gophers this coming Thursday and Friday in the Twin Cities. There will be a Game 7 in the baseball playoffs. The American League Championship Series goes to a Game 7 tonight after Texas beat Houston 9-2. So that series knotted at 3 games apiece. And so the Rangers and the Astros will square off to find out who goes to the World Series tonight in Houston. On the National League side of things, Arizona is at Philadelphia tonight in Game 6. So Philly leads that 3-2. So they just need to win tonight, or even if they lose tonight, they would have to win tomorrow in a Game 7 if necessary. So, you know, the Phils are home for 1 or 2 games, just have to win the one, and they head off to the World Series. And that will all get started, I believe, Friday night is where we're going to end up on Game 1 of the World Series. All right, let's unpack some of the headlines here. Again, you're always free to join us at 844-967-2789. This is the part where we say, hey, what did we miss over the weekend? Did, like, Republicans get things together and elect a new speaker? No. No, they did not. Not only do they not have a speaker, but since you and I visited last, the Republican conference, what we call the caucus here in the legislature, but in Congress, they call it the conference, the Republican conference. All the members got together, held a secret ballot after Jim Jordan lost 3 attempts to become speaker. And in a secret ballot, they basically kicked him out as their nominee and said, nope, we're going to try somebody else. So who are they going to try? Don't know. Why? Because there are nine candidates now for speaker among House Republicans. I mean, 10 if you count the knuckleheads who still think they want Donald Trump to be speaker, but that ain't happening. But the fact of the matter is there's now 9 people in that room, none of whom were on the ballot before, but all of whom think they've got what it takes to be the speaker. So how will that resolve itself? Well, I guess reformers would say you should institute that instant runoff voting, where everybody just ranks their choices, and then you just keep eliminating, you know, the person in last place and reallocating to their second choice and so forth and so on until you've got it down to 2 candidates. I don't think they're going to do that. I think there's going to be multiple ballots here because, again, you still have, this is a group of people where, again, 96% of them were fine with Kevin McCarthy as speaker. But Kevin McCarthy made a deal where the other 4%, these 8 people, were able to unseat Kevin McCarthy and stand in the way of, you know, Steve Scalise getting in, the number 2 Republican there at the time. Now, after Jim Jordan was up there, and he is one of the right wingers, all the rest of the conference said no to him. He kept getting more no votes with each round of balloting. And so you have this, you know, schism right now between the far right members and the right wing members. I would not dare tell you there are any moderate, you know, truly moderate Republicans in there. And that is one of the more frustrating things, I think, for people watching, especially those folks who are moderate to, you know, center left folks, is that there isn't, say, you know, a John McCain type figure that could step up and say, you know, look, I'm not a fire breathing guy, but I want to do what's good for the country. I want to do what's good for the party, and that people would rally around that person. The closest thing that I see to it would be Tom Emmer of Minnesota, who is the House Majority Whip right now. But Tom Emmer hasn't been there terribly long. I want to say maybe 6 years or something like that. And so, you know, he doesn't quite have the seniority, but he might be the one out of the 9 who could garner the votes. And again, I say that knowing not a lot about all of the characters, but I've seen enough of the voting records and some of the temperament of some of the members that it just leads me to this conclusion. This Republican bloc in the House of Representatives right now is not really a bloc. I mean, they are all Republicans, but they are so fractured among themselves that, again, in any other Western democracy, they would be going back and forth with a bloc of Democrats, or, you know, with each other as blocs to reach some kind of an agreement, to form some kind of a coalition. And right now, it's just these, by and large, 8 or so extreme members who are gunking up the whole works, which has me wondering, is that on purpose? Is the whole notion to keep this thing just at a standstill till you get to the deadline where there has to be a government shutdown again? And if that's the case, then what recourse is there? Is it at that point that some Republicans turn to Democrats and say, look, you guys only need four of us to flip, and then Hakeem Jeffries, the Democratic leader, becomes Speaker, let's make a deal? Because until we do that, there's not going to be funding for Israel. There's not going to be humanitarian aid for the Palestinians in Gaza. There's not going to be funding for Ukraine. There's not going to be funding to shore up Taiwan. You continue to have one senator, blocking military nominations. You have George Santos, who's inexplicably still a member of the House. Bob Menendez, who's still inexplicably a member of the Senate. You have a budget deal that's got to get done. All of these things are going nowhere until either if the Republicans agree amongst themselves or a handful of them turn to Democrats and say, what does it take to get the country rolling again? It's all wait and see. Plans are already being made for the third Republican debate, and there are some folks wondering why. Should there even be any more debates? Does Donald Trump have such a lead that this is all for show? You know, we heard a lot in the past week or so that there was increased sniping between Nikki Haley and Ron DeSantis. But as others pointed out, so what? I mean, if you're both behind 40 points in the polling, does it really matter which one's ahead of the other? Although to this point, you know, up until now, that next Republican debate is being held sometime next month, and only three of the candidates have qualified so far. And that would be Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, and Vivek Ramaswamy. Right now, Chris Christie and Mike Pence would not qualify. They are far short of the 70,000 donors that they would need to get there. And South Carolina Senator Tim Scott, his polling numbers are too low to qualify for the next debate. So that field, which was so monstrously large in the beginning, everybody hoping they'd be the alternative to the Trump MAGA folks, well, they've all kind of melted away. And you've got the Trump MAGA folks who are holding up the Republican Party in the House of Representatives. So at this point, like it or not, it's still Donald Trump's party, no matter what harm that does to the country. Let's take a break here. I think we'll be visiting with Kristen Lyerly and unpacking more of the day's headlines right after this. You're up north. Nothing to do but cry. Raininess Monday's always good. Me down. Well, hey there.
Hi. How are you guys?
Well, we're good. How are you?
Good.
All right. So, let's see. Oh, you're now. When do you hit the road at some point here, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Eight. Yep.
Still clinging to your green and gold, even on a Monday like this, huh?
Yeah. I'm a proud fan. I lived through the Packers in the 70s, and by God, I will stand by them now.
Good. Okay. Give you this. There we go. How'd the weekend go otherwise?
Good. It was nice. I got some stuff done. Had some good conversations. I think Threads is picking up.
Oh, it really is. Yeah, I really noticed that this past week or so. And so that's that was a good thing. And Blue Sky to a lesser extent, and I think as more people get invitations from that, I have a feeling it'll just be those two, just because there's enough people that don't want to just put everything in the Mark Zuckerberg Facebook camp to go with Threads. But we'll see. But yeah, I'm always looking for more excuses to post more stuff over on Threads.
Me too. Did you happen to see the Gays Against Groomers information that I posted?
I did. Yeah. Do you want to bring that up?
Sure.
Okay. And then, like, a couple of people commented, like, were they, like, in the parking lot at Lambeau or on the sidewalks or where was this?
I believe they were standing along Lombardi Avenue.
Gotcha. Okay. Let's see. All right. Now I'm going to ask you about crisis pregnancy centers. All right. Otherwise, I'm still kind of cobbling things together as we move along here because it was just a
It's Monday.
Weekend. It's Monday and it was a busy weekend.
Uh-huh.
All right, there we go.
You had some pretty neat stuff out on social media, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was just trying to remember it all as I was putting some notes together here.
Yeah.
All right. Here we go. A few seconds. Dwight Yoakam's birthday today, and we will talk more about that in a bit. I heard Dwight for a second, then he just kind of dropped right out. But trust me, I think that was Dwight Yoakam in the background singing Fast as You, as we bring in Dr. Kristen Lyerly, as we often do on Monday mornings. How are you?
I'm good. Happy Monday.
Yeah, I was initially going to play the Carpenters' Rainy Days and Mondays when you came on just to get your reaction to playing something sappy and sad, and I decided no, we needed a bit more of an upbeat intro for you.
I can't ever hear the Carpenters without thinking about how Karen Carpenter died of anorexia. It like is the thing that always pops into my head, and it ruins it for me.
You're just a ray of sunshine to get this segment rolling today, aren't you? Wow, that's a good
it was a formative time in my life when it happened, I guess.
No, I mean, look, I know the Carpenters catalog front to back, and yes, it was a terrible end for her. And again, you try to turn it into the learning experience that you hope that other people saw that and are more aware of eating disorders and maybe prevent some of those bad things from happening.
Mm-hmm. I think about it a lot with my patients. I mean, we see it commonly.
Mm-hmm. And you've still got your green and gold flannel on. You're not.
Hells yes, I do.
Not giving up on the team.
No, so like I told you in the break, I lived through the Packers in the 70s. I'm hooked. It doesn't win, lose, or draw. I'm a Packer fan.
Oh, no. It was still a good time. We still made it to our little neighborhood pub in time for the game, which we were always going to do anyway. It's just that Sherry and I thought that this was going to be kind of more of a weekend of leisure. And then we really had next weekend set aside for all the fall house stuff. But we got home yesterday afternoon after doing some stuff in the cities. And we got home and we had a couple of hours before the game. And the weather was a lot nicer than they were predicting. They said it was going to be like overcast and it was really sunny and nice. So we thought, okay, well, let's do one or two things. Let's do the storm door. So I had to replace the storm door and then it was still nice and we still had time. We're like, well, let's go ahead and swap out the tops on the Jeep. So we took off the soft top and put on the hard top. I'm like, well, it's still nice. And so, you know, she's going around cutting the hydrangeas. You know, you got to deadhead those things at the end of the year. And next thing you know, we're putting away the patio furniture into the shed. And pretty soon I'm realizing I am just drenched, you know, with sweat because we'd been working so hard on all these things. Like, if we're going to go see this game, I got to go take a shower now and, you know, get your green and gold on and head in. But it was such a lovely day. And I was telling Sam earlier, what a great day for a drive yesterday, you know, with the sun hitting there was a lot of, you know, a lot of yellow, a lot of rust out there. So it was not a bad weekend at all.
I'm really excited to drive home from northern Minnesota today because the trees are perfect. Even way up here, I'm a few latitudes higher than where you are, and it is just absolutely stunning.
Yeah. No, you're gonna like that very much. One of the things we did this weekend was a good friend of mine dating back to high school. She has always wanted to be a singer in a band. And finally, after taking early retirement from her teaching job, that's what she's doing. She's with these two other guys and sings in this kind of this acoustic trio. And we got to go see her do a show over the weekend. And the thing that I thought was really very impressive was she dedicated a song to her husband. It was Eric Clapton's Wonderful Tonight. But she turned the lyrics around, you know, kind of reverse gendered those and sang it as a love song to her husband. And I thought that was really sweet and not the kind of thing a lot of people could necessarily do is get up on stage and, you know, serenade their loved one, husband, wife, or otherwise. So you get bonus points for that.
It's never too late to live your dream, buck up and find that courage and get out there and do it. And look at she's your friend from high school and look at how you're talking about it on the radio this morning.
Yeah.
What kind of a huge impact does that have on you and the people in your life, but also the people who surround you?
I think you could see it in the crowd that was there at this winery where we were. And, you know, a bunch of us who were sitting around him just kind of all got up and laid back so that they could just kind of have the moment to themselves. And it, you know, it reminded me that I actually did do the same thing once. It was the one time I did karaoke and belted
tell
out
us more.
Belted out a Sinatra tune. And I could tell Sherry was impressed, but I could also, you know, we probably had consumed the same amount of fermented malt beverages before that happened. So I might in my mind be upgrading the quality of my singing at that point, you know, but that's different than actually in a sober frame of mind, mapping out an entire performance, you know, to your husband.
So it's totally different. We'll have to go to Sherry for the results on that one.
For the rebuttal. Yes, exactly. We did a little shopping over the weekend as well. And, you know, there are more of these places, you know, Warby Parker is one. I saw two or three others, you know, where we were at that, you know, they're really kind of mass producing eyeglass frames now. And didn't I see you wear glasses once or twice?
Yeah, pretty much my whole life.
Yeah. Same here. And, you know, as I'm getting on here and what I refer to as my elderly adolescence, I'm liking the contacts a little less and less. They used to be good for like, you know, 14 hours a day. And then it was 8 hours a day. And now it's at 8:01 in the morning when I get off the radio. And so we started looking around at frames because there's so many different styles and so many different ways to wear them. And I think that might be the next thing we do here is, do I crowdsource that as well? Since the audience did such a good job on getting me to wear these Chelsea boots and this particular cut of jeans, I'm just going to have to get a whole bunch of glass frames and have everybody, you know, watch the video feed to the radio show and we'll put it up for a vote. How's that?
I saw your Facebook posts over the weekend and you are rocking the style, Pat.
Thank you.
It's logical to go to glasses next because you've got to complete the look.
I guess so. Yeah. Hey, if that's what it takes, I will crowdsource that. Although I did realize in cleaning the shed yesterday that I actually do have a next hobby. Remember I said it was maybe going to be cooking or something like that. Mm-hmm. I have so many half open, half finished little cases of nuts and bolts and screws and basically they should all go. So I don't do jigsaw puzzles, but I think I found my winter jigsaw puzzle is just this I mean, basically, I should just throw them all into a 5-gallon bucket, and I think it would fit, and then just separate out all the nuts, the bolts, the screws, the washers, the you name it. It's a wonder that we have found everything. Well, I want to say we have found everything through luck, but clearly not. Clearly, I have bought things that I already had. I just didn't know that I had them because my workbench organization is, shall we say, non-existent. So there's my puzzle. That's what I've got to do.
If you take them out of those little boxes, like the boxes are labeled, so they're organized, they're not.
No, they're not. No, these are just the little kits and things that I buy, they're not labeled that way. So yeah, it's like buying a puzzle without actually having the box so you can see what the finished product is supposed to look like. It's like, you guess, you take a guess at it. Hey, over the weekend, you were kind of monitoring things, and back home, there was an anti-gay protest along Lombardi Avenue.
Not anti-gay. It was gays against groomers. It was an anti-trans protest.
Oh, an anti-trans. My apologies. It was gays against groomers.
It's weird.
Okay. I'm not even sure that I buy that entirely. And again, anybody using the word groomer is most likely doing so inappropriately and for cynical and frankly vicious reasons. But it was interesting that among the people at these anti-trans protest, did I see right, 3 legislators in that area?
Yes. Well, there were a total of 18 people showed up throughout the time of the actual protest. 3 were children, 3 were assembly members. John Mako, Nate Gustafson, and Joy Gobin, all members of the Wisconsin State Assembly, and there was a Mom for Liberty there. So there seemed to be people who, I don't know that they were necessarily members of the gay community. They're not known to be members of the gay community, but they certainly are members of the extremist right-wing Republican community representing, I don't know what, at this hate group event. And Gays Against Groomers is known to be a hate group. Actually, the person who leads it in Northeast Wisconsin had issued death threats against a member of the Pulaski School Board at some point. So this is a really worrisome organization. And to see members of our assembly show up holding signs on Lombardi Avenue on a Saturday morning, what does that mean?
Signs denouncing trans people.
Signs denouncing. So their whole shtick is that they are protecting children. Mm-hmm. And they're protecting children from things that they don't understand, from becoming trans people. But clearly they don't understand the spectrum of people who deal with LGBTQ issues.
Well, they also don't have the self-awareness to understand that by and large, the children need to be protected from them. They're the ones who are choking off public education. They're the ones who are standing in the way of healthcare. These are the folks who are causing some of our best and brightest young people to go elsewhere when they hit adulthood because of the environment that they have fostered. And now they just want to add to that by fostering an environment of hate toward certain types of people. It's no longer just an animosity toward taxes and towards spending and toward education, but now it's towards people for, you know, who they love or what they believe or what they stand for. That's my view here, is it essentially calls out to me, these people standing along a Lombardi Avenue are the people that our children need to be protected from. But the only way that happens is if we get more people to show up on election day.
Yes. Hey, and another thing is these people are so visible and their message is so twisted that it's really confusing for the general public. So we have to have more conversations where we unearth what this really means and we recognize what's important in our communities and how we can stand together to fight back against this. I mean, I know you're going to have the Motherhood for Good folks on later today to see Moms for Liberty show up at this rally. Just another misplaced, really terrible representation of what's happening in our schools.
It is. And that's where, again, I'm so thankful for these women standing up as moms to form Motherhood for Good, to let people see the type of involvement, civic involvement, that moms and working parents overall shouldn't be afraid to have. To not say, oh, you know, I don't do politics. And what do we always say here? If you don't do politics, politics is going to do you. And so better that you be involved in this and stand up against hate groups like Moms for Liberty and others that are, you know, against all manner of things that would make us better educated, more diverse, more tolerant. We're also going to mention briefly that the state Senate last week, we'll talk to Senator Kelda Roys along with them next hour, and they approved some funding for crisis pregnancy centers. Again, if that's something that Governor Evers can veto, there's a good chance that he will. But again, it's just our reminder to folks that so-called crisis pregnancy centers severely limit. They're not exactly full centers. They're more about, frankly, indoctrination.
They're not at all full centers, Pat. Yeah. They are not healthcare centers. They market themselves as healthcare providers, but they are not licensed. They have no obligation to protect your privacy, and they don't have to give you accurate information, and often they don't. I've seen patients who have initially gone to crisis pregnancy centers thinking that they were getting healthcare, and they show up in my office with an ultrasound picture of their bladder that they were told was their uterus. I mean, this is bad healthcare. It's coercion. I saw someone recently who was coerced into keeping a pregnancy, and now with a very complicated health history, mental health, physical health, she's 25 weeks pregnant and she's completely falling apart with a number of issues because she was coerced to keep a pregnancy that she knew she couldn't handle. Crisis pregnancy centers are not healthcare centers.
And again, those same legislators who voted to fund these things are the people who are taking part in some of these ugly demonstrations like we saw in Green Bay over the weekend. Kristen's going to hang around. Selena Heller is going to join us as well. And when we come back, we'll have today's history lesson and a little music break. And then, as we mentioned, in the next hour, our friends from Motherhood for Good and Senator Kelda Roys, Terry Bell still joining us along the way as well. This is Up North News Radio for a Monday morning, October 23rd. We'll be back. And there she is now. Hello.
Hello. Good morning. Hello.
Good morning.
Person sending me messages at midnight again.
So. I thought, well, it's earlier than normal.
Not much.
I'm excited. I have heat.
Oh, congratulations.
Yes.
Yeah, you were, it was on Monday. Wasn't it last Monday? Were we talking about this on the radio or did it happen after? No, it happened after Monday because after you came back.
That's Monday night, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. No pilot lights.
No pilot lights. And I'm really, you know, all's well that ends well because I'm so excited because there's a fireplace downstairs that has never been on before. And he got that working too.
Well, okay.
Bonus.
Bonus. I didn't die and the fireplace works.
Yeah. I didn't have heat for a week, but it's all good now.
That's funny. Let's see here. There, we'll do that. Okay. All right. So I've got your stories for 7:20. And yeah, our new clock starts on Wednesday. Kristen, that will not affect hometown health at all. It will, that block is the one thing that doesn't really change.
Ooh, I need to grab this. I'm getting a phone call.
Okay, go for it.
And to Pat, that the teacher from Brookfield won the National Teacher of the Year. They sent me an email about that. So,
okay, we'll get that next hour too.
I'll probably be talking with him later today.
Okay, that'll be great. Mm-hmm. All right, 10 seconds here. Hey, whoa. The number one song this day in 1961 was Dion with Run Around Sue. Time for today's history lesson, music break. Kristen Lyerly's here. Selena Heller is here. Morning, Selena.
Good morning.
Somebody's missing. Normally we see at least part of Whiskers at this point, usually the tail. I didn't say you had to bring him in,
well,
but
he's,
sure.
He's not far.
Okay. No, he never is he?
All right. Nope.
One gray dust mop accounted for. All right. It was on, perfect. On this. By the way, before I get to this part, I want to let Roger know, one of our listeners who comments frequently online. I didn't forget you. I had this one ready to go, Roger. You're going to find out in just a second here. But first, I'm going to tell you that Dwight Yoakam turned 67, as I mentioned earlier. So let's hear a little bit of Ain't That Lonely Yet while I tell you what else is in the works for the calendar for today. It was on this day in 2001 that Apple Computer released the iPod. Did you get an iPod, Selena, when they first came out?
I have never had an iPod, nope.
You've never had an iPod?
No.
Wow. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Just never had one.
That's right. You didn't have an iPhone until very recently, did you?
Well, I had an iPhone before.
Okay.
A couple, phone ago or something.
Well, I was going to say, how did you get your music digitally back in those days?
I just never really did. I wasn't a techie kid.
Okay. All right. The iPod came out this day in 2001. Johnny Carson was born on this day in 1925, 98 years ago. He passed away in 2005. And actor Ryan Reynolds is 47 years old today. This is also, and let me get Roger's comment here and throw it up. He says, Pat, if you want to put on your inner Les Nessman, today is the 88th birthday of a famous golfer. Yeah, I knew that, Roger, because I went and found the clip from WKRP in Cincinnati. Take it away, Les Nessman.
Turning to sports. Winner of this week's Gulf Coast Golf Classic was Chai Chai Rodriguez. Chai Chai finished 9 under par. Chichi Rodriguez. Hopefully, Mr. Rodriguez will play up the ball.
Oh, God bless Les Nessman. Yes, Chichi Rodriguez is 88. And I promise you, I don't know if it happened to you, Selena, but back in the late 90s when I started anchoring the news, mm-hmm. once or twice, his name came up in the teleprompter, and you have to think about it because you're so used to joking about Chai Chai Rodriguez. You had to make sure not to say it that way when you were actually delivering a serious newscast or doing sports.
Mm-hmm. I don't think that ever happened.
Okay. Let's see. Kristen, did we get you back?
Yeah, I'm back. Sorry. Labor.
Your connection sounds like something out of Star Trek here.
Yeah, I have to get my AirPods rehooked up.
Okay.
Here we go.
No, you still sound like a robot.
Wait, don't now.
You? Now try. Oh, no, she does. Oh, ooh. All right. You want to disconnect and come back in? Let's do that. All right. She's going to try that. Meanwhile, we're going to mention that the birthdays roll on. This is the birthday. Happy 64th birthday to Weird Al Yankovic.
Hey, like a surgeon. Cutting for the very first time.
Yeah, like the list of Weird Al Yankovic songs is far too many to handle in one two-hour radio show. From, you know, I Love Rocky Road, one of the early ones, to some of his more recent work, including the Hamilton Polka. And if any of you have seen Hamilton, have you both seen Hamilton?
No.
No? Oh.
No. Oh. I've wanted to see it so badly, but I have not yet.
Oh, okay.
I have a theater kid who refuses to see it, but I think he's going to come around, so I'm waiting to see it with him.
Okay. All right. You haven't listened to the soundtrack either? I mean, because basically the play is the soundtrack. You'd love the soundtrack. Anyway, once you do, and once you've listened to it a few times, because I guarantee you will, then you've got to listen to Weird Al's version of the Hamilton Polka. And you'll understand it's a work of genius. It just is. Chicago had the number one hit this day in 1976. Let's all get schmaltzy.
Mm-hmm.
there with rainy days and Mondays.
I love this song, though. And no anorexia.
What? You have to go there again? It's just so sad. All right, Carrie Underwood, we mentioned for two events in history, 8 years apart. On this day in 2007, Carrie Underwood released just her second studio album, Carnival Ride, which debuted at number one. Here's the single Last Name from there.
My mama would be so ashamed. Started off, hey, cutie, where you from? And then it turned into, oh no, what have I done? And I...
Last Name earned her a Grammy Award for Best Female Country Vocal Performance. And then 8 years later, on this day in 2015, following the release of her acclaimed Greatest Hits Decade Number One album, Carrie Underwood issued her fifth studio album, Storyteller. A chart-topping hit, it made her the first artist in history to have six consecutive number one albums on the country chart.
And let's remember that she did not win American Idol.
No, she didn't. Wait, she didn't, did she?
Or was she a winner? Did she beat Bo Bice? I can't remember.
See, now we got to
we have to Google
that thing. We're all Googling like crazy over here.
I was thinking about all the people who didn't win, though, and went on, like, who's
yes,
the...
Yes, she did. She won the fourth season of American Idol. Mm. Yes.
Okay, sorry.
No, that's...
Thanks for fact-checking.
happy to do that. No, but you're right. There have been some where the person that came in second or even not at all did extremely well. But no, Carrie Underwood was indeed a champion of that. And I loved that her first Greatest Hits album, well, that she knew it would be her first one, you know, that you call it Greatest Hits Decade Number One. I'm like, wow, you're believing something there. So good on you. It's good to have that kind of self-assurance, you know. Selena, we already talked about the wonderful weekend for driving that I had around Western Wisconsin. Kristen's making a big drive today. Hopefully has some nice weather to check out the colors. Did your weekend include any leaf peeping, as they call it out west or out east?
Yes, on the way, we went to, of all places, Strum over the weekend. So
no.
There's a nice just in the hills going through to Strum. Mm-hmm. From Claire. So it's beautiful, all of those hills and valleys through there.
Love that area. You know, anytime you're heading between Eau Claire and La Crosse and can get into the Cooley region like that, it is super nice. So with that said, Kristen, have a lovely drive.
Leaf peeping?
That sounds weird.
That's
what they call it in New England when all the New Yorkers come up. They're all leaf peepers.
That's weird.
I know. I almost felt dirty saying it, but it was what it was. Kristen, we'll see you Thursday for Hometown Health.
Sounds great. Can't wait.
All right. And Selena will be back after we check the news, some commercials, get your forecast and more. We'll be back. This is Up North News Radio. All right.
All right. Got to go take care of a baby.
Okay. See ya.
Bye.
Bye.
Those darn babies.
They just come.
No respect at all. All right. I will be back.
Okay.
All right. So, Selena, what are you working on first this morning?
I'll probably try to get a hold of the principal. I said teacher before.
Oh,
principal.
Yes. Okay. All right.
I was supposed to be set up for today, but I haven't heard back yet. But they sent me the email about that he won. So.
Okay. And then again, with this new little workflow thing of trying to work a couple of days ahead, I think the today radio bit that we'll work on today to get to them by tomorrow morning to post up on Wednesday will be something from Kelda Roys coming up here at 7:30. Okay. Most likely about childcare, that even though Evers, gave it a reprieve, it still needs to be fully funded. But I'm also going to be asking her about the Republicans firing all those appointees last week and also about funding crisis pregnancy centers. And so that one will be a definite must for a clip. So we're actually probably going to get three clips out of this.
Okay.
But the big difference is now instead of rushing to get something on social media same day, you know, again, unless it's really big news, we'll try to do this staggered thing. So,
okay.
So be on the lookout for those things today.
Okay. Sounds good.
And what I might do, what you or I might do, depending on who gets to it, is if Kelda gives us something good on crisis pregnancy centers, we'll marry it with, I asked Kristen about it in the last hour. So we'll get like a back-to-back, you know, double soundbite out of it or something.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see. Oh, I need a 7:15 song. Sam, are you listening? Are you there? Probably not back yet. Were you watching the Packer game at all?
I didn't watch yesterday. We had gymnastics. So, no, I thought they'd have it on where we were, but they did not. So,
okay.
Mm-hmm. I did not even get to see.
Oh, Kristen missed her chance. By having to leave, she missed what the days here, and she promised that she was going to make one of these days happen today. Seconds.
Across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wasota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlove.
And welcome back to Up North News Radio for this Monday, October 23rd. Coming up, we're going to talk to our friends from Motherhood for Good, and they'll be joined by Senator Kelda Roys to tell us how, while it's a good thing Governor Tony Evers provided a reprieve to child care providers by temporarily saving the child care accounts program, Only the legislature can fund it to a sustainable level. And as Senator Roys will tell us, Republicans in the state Senate are not feeling particularly charitable as we talk about some of last week's votes that they took last week. Also, Civic Media News Director Terry Bell has three things you should know to start the week. And Selena Heller is with us now on this October 23rd, which means on the calendar here, it is National Boston Cream Pie Day. No, no, I'm a no on Boston Cream Pie.
You're a no.
Yeah, I'm a no.
I could go either way.
You can take it or leave. It's National iPod Day. We've already established that you never owned an iPod.
Never.
It's National Mole Day, not the animal, the chemistry algorithm. Do you remember moles in your chemistry class?
Oh my gosh, that is not the first thing I would have thought.
No, no. And I've long since, I have no idea. I have no concept of what that was anymore. It's National...
That's 10 to the 23rd.
Oh, I'm sorry, Sam. What?
One mole is it's like a number, like pi or e or something. One mole is 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd power.
First off, did you really know this?
Yeah.
Why?
And second, yeah. Why are you working in a radio station when you have that kind of wizardry going on?
I don't know. I'm a bit of a hobby chemist, I guess. I
need. And you need to know a mole?
I don't need to. I just like, it's just something I remembered from when I was in high school, I guess.
It's just there. You know, it's like 70s song lyrics to me. Just one of those things you can't hit control alt delete on that. It's just, it's always going to be there. And then last but not least, and Kristen Lyerly promised to do something about it today. Mm-hmm. Today is Slap Your Annoying Coworker Day.
Oh, geez.
Which cannot be a real thing, obviously, because this would also be National Human Resources Director has to write you up day. But apparently it's a day to think about that annoying coworker that you like to slap upside the head. And that's where I'm very thankful that Dr. Lyerly and you and everybody else that works with me is a safe distance away. So that, you know, I can continue to say whatever it is I want to say and not pay any physical price for it anyway.
I've never thought about doing that, so you know.
But what I do know is because we worked in the same newsroom for many years, we can think of annoying coworkers of the past that we would like to slap.
They do exist.
We're not going to list any names here. And now all of the Channel 13 people are going to be asking us about it one of these days. Who are you talking about? Oh, not you. Not you at all.
Oh, wink. Goodness.
Gosh. So we've now learned that Sam rebuilds engines. He bakes his own bread. He is a part-time chemist. I mean, I feel like we're learning so much more than we did in that early introduction, just in little drips and drabs here, Sam.
I mean, I don't know. I'm an open book, but I don't really talk about myself a ton.
I know. See, we have to bring these things out in you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So, the have you put the chemistry to use in anything other than, you know, cooking and baking? Shall we say? I mean, do we have to worry about you making anything dangerous?
No.
You have labs in your basement.
Yes, that's what we're trying to say. Are you familiar with the show Breaking Bad by chance?
I'm actually watching it right now.
I don't need to know anything more about Sam as a chemist. I think we have resolved that issue. And Selena, no chemistry for you?
No, we have a... So in my school, it was a very well-known chemistry teacher. He would always say he was known for saying... Chemistry is easy, and we all thought chemistry is not easy.
No, it is not. I think, like a lot of things, if you're drawn to it, you know, it will surprise you, and then it will all start to click in. I know. I certainly saw that in my sister-in-law. My wife is the oldest of six, and I saw in one case a sister go to college and start to just really get into chemistry. And she was like making models and in the dorm room, and they shared a dorm room, and she'd show Sherry. She'd be like, guess what this is? And she'd be like, two styrofoam balls, you know, or something like that. No, it's hydrogen or helium or whatever. And then the other one, you know, just out of the blue, is just like, hey, this finance stuff is really cool. And now she's like this big time, you know, certified financial planner or whatever. I didn't have any epiphanies like that in college. I just got there and I'm just like, oh, here's a radio station. Here's a microphone. Here's a TV camera. I like this. No big knowledge base whatsoever, which, you know, might explain the predicament that I find myself in career wise these days. Although I had a big meeting last week, Selena. I know it's weird to think that we are talking about these things since we worked together so long ago, but I had my first meeting with somebody to talk about, if I look at retiring in a few years, you know, are we on track for that? And what would that look like? And it's funny because up until, you know, maybe a year, maybe 2 years ago, I wouldn't have even dreamed of doing that. Mm-hmm. And now here we are at that point already. Time flies way too fast.
Well, yeah, I know. When I think we talked about that a month or two ago about you retiring and if you thought about it and how quickly things change.
I know. You think of all the people we saw come by, you know, just fresh out of college, you know. Anyway, time flies like this segment did. So we're going to do sports and weather coming up right after this break. You're up north. I am so out of it with this new clock not starting until Wednesday. I'm like, because I'm already thinking about it. It's like, no, you don't have to talk till 7:19 yet in a couple of days, you know, but it's just
so what's
weird.
Happening.
They're switching the commercial clock. And so the break that we right now have at 13, now we have to talk all the way to 19.
Oh,
and then it's only a 1 minute break. And then you go till 29. And then there's a 5 minute break down there. And then it's, 15 minutes and then 8 minutes again, with just a 1 minute break in between. So, you know, so these big breaks at the top and bottom, and you're virtually talking straight through each of the half hours, you know, except for a 1 minute break. So I'm trying to figure out if there's some other elements, you know, we can put into this. Should I be a bit more regimented about doing, you know, the music history at this point instead of that point, something else. Okay. So anyway, suggestions are welcome, as they say. Yeah. Sam right away said, nope, I'm not in this discussion. That's it. I want no part of this.
We could have a chemistry segment. What are you making this week?
I think what's Sam making this week? I like that.
Surprise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's see. Oh, I did not get temperatures. That's okay. All right. So we'll see if Jen comes up. Well, that was the other thing. Kristen sent me an audio clip of Jennifer Vucicki saying her last name. And I'm like, well, that's how I say it. And she's like, no, it's not. I'm like, yes, it is. No. So we're now debating whether I say her name the right way.
Oh, are you going to ask her?
No, not. If it was bad, she'd correct me on air. So.
You think so?
Well, I hope so. Yeah. All right, here we go. Again, it's Weird Al's birthday today. Weird Al Yankovic.
I hear those ice cream bells.
And this is I Love Rocky Road, which I don't know that Joan Jett did or did not appreciate, but Weird Al is 64 years old today. Selena Heller is with us as well, and we're going to talk about some of the stories that she's been covering for Up North News in just a bit. But first, we've got a very large area of rain spreading across Wisconsin right now. If you're not wet, the radar sure makes it sound like you're going to get a little precipitation coming your way before you know it. But to find out what it's going to do temperature-wise, precip-wise, and apparently quite a cool down coming up for later in the week, let's go get that weatherology forecast. And I believe we've got Jen. Is it Jen today?
Yes, it is. Good morning. It is.
Sorry, Jen. I normally get a little note here as to whether it's you or one of your esteemed coworkers like Michael. So it was a total shot in the dark. I'm glad it's you. How are you?
I'm doing pretty well, thanks. How are you?
Good. I was just saying, according to the radar I was looking at, it's going to be a wet day for a lot of folks today.
Essentially, that's the case here. Yeah, looks like a chance for showers and storms across the board today. A few scattered showers for the early morning hours around Amory and Baldwin and also around Madison. Otherwise, a chance throughout the day everywhere else. A little bit of a break in the evening hours, then redeveloping in the late night overnight hours. There is a marginal risk for severe weather for those late night storms from Baldwin through central Wisconsin, with the main threat being large hail, so definitely something we'll keep you posted on. High temperatures kind of all over the place today. Our coolest spot around Wausau getting into the upper 40s, mid-50s to around 60 for nearly everyone else. Our warmest spots, Madison and Richland Center, getting into the low to mid-60s. Tuesday, a chance for showers and storms across the board once again, mainly just for the morning hours from Madison over towards Milwaukee, then redeveloping at night. Otherwise, a chance throughout the day for most everyone else. Another marginal risk for severe weather from Richland Center northward. So once again, something we'll keep you posted on. And once again, mainly a large hail threat for tomorrow. Temperature-wise, warmer tomorrow as the warm front pushes through, getting up above average for all in the 70s from Wisconsin Rapids southward, then around the mid-60s from Wausau over towards Amory. Wednesday, another chance for showers and storms for all. That's kind of the story here this week. Highs in the mid-60s to around 70s for most. Low 60s for west central Wisconsin. Then for the second half of the work week, chance for showers and storms both days, Thursday and Friday, but starting to cool off as the cold front begins to push through. 60s on Thursday from Wisconsin Rapids southward, upper 50s around west central Wisconsin to Wausau. Then on Friday, pretty similar, slightly cooler, but actually seeing those highs in the morning around Amory and Baldwin, then slowly falling throughout the day as that cold front comes in.
Whew. So we're talking, are we talking 30s before too long here? For temps or even for highs?
We could potentially see some of that for some areas for the weekend, particularly around Amory and Baldwin.
Okay. So in other words, all of us who switched our plans and did all of our raking and winter stuff or winter prep this weekend, we are being rewarded for doing that and not waiting till next weekend because it
sounds... Yep, that was a good plan.
Yeah, sounds like I did the right thing there. All right, Jennifer, thanks so much. Have a great day.
You too.
All right. Selena Heller joins us as well to talk about stories that she's been working on for Up North News, a separate entity from Courier Newsroom, but we're a separate entity from Civic Media, but we're happy to be a part of it. Up North News is part of Courier Newsroom. Pat's having a terrible case of the Mondays today here, so this seems like a good time to turn and see what Selena's been working on instead. When she was talking about the cooler weather, and I was going to make some kind of a hunting reference because we're definitely getting into that season now. And I've been seeing signs in some places about donating, you know, hide and other things. And that's part of a story you're working on as well, I guess.
Yes. There's a program in Wisconsin through the DNR that hunters can donate their deer for, and they go to food pantries across the state. So it's pretty easy. The program is set up so it makes life simple. If you have a deer, if you have two tags and you want to not have one and you want to give that away, you can do that. If you just want to hunt and then give your deer away, you can do that too. So there are processors across the state that are participating in the program. All you have to do is field dress the deer, register it. In some counties, there are CWD areas. So if the county is an affected CWD area, then you have to get it tested. But otherwise, you just call up the food pantries or the processors that are participating and then bring it there and see if they have room for it at that time. And it's a great program because then I think there was like 100,000 deer donated and totaling 3.8 million pounds of venison over the years since the program began in the year 2000. So it's great to feed the families if you can do that.
Yeah, without a doubt. Okay. So yeah, folks, keep that in mind. And then there are a couple of fall-based stories or weather-based stories that you've been working on recently as well, including one with another person who works at TV13, where we worked once upon a time, and that would be one of the meteorologists talking about why it kind of feels like autumn skipped right by. It's not exactly summer, but it's not quite as autumny as it has been in years past.
That's right. And I suppose, you know, we kind of say that every year in Wisconsin, don't we?
Yeah.
Do we skip a season because it's always winter seems so long. Mm-hmm. So we always, you know, think two seasons are longer than the other. So that's what I talked to him about, our weather as an extension of two seasons, winter and summer. And so we started out the month in the 80s. So we had a string of days in the warm weather, and then we haven't had frost. So that's odd. We usually have a lot of frost by this time of the year in October. So that's one of the reasons. And he said, and it's kind of, you know, the fall foliage isn't as bright. Now it kind of is getting into that, the peaking now, but earlier it didn't seem like it. So then we don't see just kind of our surroundings. It doesn't seem like fall. And then it's been fairly dry. So that's another indication, you know, when we think of fall, it's rainy and kind of cloudy and gloomy. Well, we haven't had a lot of rain. So then that's another reason why we don't think it's fall time now. But then he said, coming up, it's an El Nino winter. So we look to have not necessarily a lot of snow and below average temperature. So we'll see about that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it really feels like we've made a transition here. I mean, just today with it getting all cloudy and rainy again. And from what Jen just told us.
Right. It's going to be this.
It's going to be extremely fall-like moving forward here. So, and, you know, it's not just Darren Meyer, but a lot of weather folks, you know, are where they are because of somebody who has been doing weather on TV for many, many years, and a Chicago institution who has, like I said, been an inspiration to people throughout the country, is hanging it up, I guess.
Yeah, Tom Skilling, he is kind of a well-known in the industry, and I suppose not even in the industry because people watch him all the time.
Oh, sure. He's from WGN, we should point out.
WGN so. In yep. Chicago, and he had a stint in Madison as well. So he's well-known just kind of across the board as being a great meteorologist. And one of our local meteorologists, Matt Schaefer at WQOW TV 18 here in Eau Claire, interned for him. And I talked with Matt about how great of a guy Tom Skilling was, and just an incredible inspiration to him, and how he can just do weather just off the cuff for 6 minutes. They made this the weather forecast long for him, and he could just talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. And so Matt talked about how great he was as an inspiration to him while he interned. And he bought the meteorologist dinner every night and the interns, and that was a, wow. a memorable thing as well.
I bet it was. And now, I didn't watch him with any regularity, but I know whenever I did catch him, one, you're right, he talks a lot. but even for the sake of talking, I mean, you really feel like you understand it. And what I'm going to say next is not a dig on TV meteorologists, but more on the consultants who talk to these TV stations and say, oh, you gotta have more weather, more weather, more weather, but it's gotta be just short. Just tell us if it's gonna rain or not. Tell us if it's gonna be sunny or not. And so you get more weather that's redundant, but you don't actually learn, you know, that there's this system coming in. And Tom would be great about, his maps were wonderful about showing the, you know, which way the wind comes in around a system, you know, one way or the other. Mm. And you felt educated, you
educated.
Know, you felt about the weather and in a very nice way, you know.
But you had a good weather lesson then.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, WGN was, you know, again, being broadcast throughout the Midwest and around the country on cable systems, you had a lot of farmers turning to that because that's where they knew they were going to get, you know, the most complete forecast, especially in those years, you know, before the Weather Channel. If memory serves me right, and of course my memory doesn't, and so I'm going to have to look it up on the fly here, but I thought it was that Tom Skilling, yep, it was his brother Jeff Skilling, who was the CEO of Enron. Remember when Enron collapsed?
Oh my gosh.
Many, many years ago? Yeah.
The CEO of Enron, really?
No. Yeah, and I think a lot of people at the time worried that, you know, that somehow, you know, Tom would be embroiled in that with for whatever reason, but thankfully not. But talk about a tale of, you know, two brothers in one family going in different directions.
That's quite different.
I know it is. Hey, you were giving us an update off air about a story that you're working on about don't we have at least one nominee for Principal of the Year?
We did. So Andy Farley is from Brookfield East High School, and mm-hmm. there were three nominees for National Principal of the Year, and they went to Washington last week, and Friday they held a gala, whichever way you want to pronounce it.
Potato, potato,
So they named the National Principal of the Year, and it was Andy Farley from Brookfield East High School, and that is the first time a principal from Wisconsin has ever received that title.
Well, congratulations. That's amazing.
It is.
He's not going to have time to do a lot of principaling with all those reporters calling him up.
I think so. He sounds like a great person. I will be talking with him today. He's mm-hmm. got a lot of cool programs in place. One of them is destigmatizing mental health, and he has trained students in the school who are part of an organization, a group that he created that help others, like their ambassadors for mental health. So that's one of the things that he does.
That's a great honor. All right. Well, cool. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll let you get to work on those things. I'll give a few sports scores that I neglected to do a few minutes back, and then we'll just talk to you a little bit later on.
All right. Sounds good.
All right. Thanks, Selena. Mm-hmm. Have a great day.
Thank you. You too.
Let's get some sports here at 7:27 real quick before we take a break and then go to our Motherhood Monday segment. The Badger football team had a nice comeback win at Illinois. They've got a national TV appearance next. They play Saturday night at Camp Randall. 6:30 is the kickoff on Saturday against Ohio State. And that game this coming Saturday for the Badger football team will be on NBC. We know about the Packers losing to the Broncos. They play the Vikings next Sunday at noon at Lambeau. The Badger women's volleyball team was handed their first loss of the season. Now it's only Nebraska at 18-0 undefeated and soon to be top ranked in a instant classic 5-set loss, 3-2. The Badger women play volleyball at Michigan State next Friday evening. The top-ranked Badger women's hockey team is now 8-0 after sweeping Bemidji State Friday and Saturday. They play in St. Paul against St. Thomas this coming Friday, Saturday. And the Badger men's hockey team swept 17th-ranked Michigan State Friday and Saturday. That 5-1 start is the team's best start since 2004-2005. Let's take a break here, talk to our friends from Motherhood for Good and Senator Kelda Roys coming up. You're up north. Thanks, Selena. See ya.
Thank you. See ya.
And there's Emily and there's Aaron. Good morning.
Hi, Pat. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Good morning. Nice to see you.
Yeah, you as well.
I didn't coordinate with you, Aaron, what Motherhood for Good wear you have on today.
I'm not wearing any. I just have on a regular old sweatshirt. I didn't tie
you
on
have
right.
those? I thought that's all we wear now.
I know. I mean, it's
you have a shopping. Uniform? Is that what you're trying to say? A Motherhood for Good uniform?
We just rotate out our merch.
Yeah, we really like our merch. We got some new fall merch, so we're excited about it.
Is there's still state Senate merch, or Senate Dems hoodies or something that you can wear? How are you, Kelda?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Good. Thanks.
Senator, I haven't met you. I'm Aaron. I just wanted to say hi. Thanks so much for being here.
Aaron, so good to be with you. Nice to see you.
Good morning. Good to see you again.
Hey. So I'm going to, let's see. Just looking at a message that came in. Okay. So we'll do a lot of childcare counts and then Kelda, I'm sure it's no surprise. I'll ask you about a couple of things like the Crisis Pregnancy Center funding. And also any candid thoughts you'd care to share about all of the appointees who were fired last week. So,
great.
Yeah. Don't hold back.
That's not usually my problem.
I know. I'm like, why am I telling you that? I mean, I'm actually... and look, I get that I'm a cynical person by nature, but even I am a little shocked that Wisconsin media didn't make a bit more of that, you know, and just kind of chalked it up to, politics. It's like, no, this is a really bad thing to do, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Any other topics from any of the three of you that we want to hit during our little segment here that we didn't mention?
Those are the big ones.
Okay. Yeah, I think that covers it.
Okay. Sounds good. I guess I would say, because Kristen in the last hour talked about the anti-trans demonstration that was going on in Green Bay. Have you guys hit up anything there about, you know, talking to your kids about, you know, trans or LGBTQ and, you know, diversity and tolerance? Or is that a little bit outside of, you know, what you're working on?
Well, I don't, and sorry, I don't know if you were asking us or on.
Yeah, either one of you, Erin or Emily.
I think that that's not outside the scope of what we're focusing on at all. Mm-hmm. I think that the approaches we tend to take are less a directive about here are ways to talk to your families, though I really like that idea, and more about just information sharing about, like, here is this dangerous rhetoric that's going on, or here's this dangerous legislation that's being proposed, and basically voicing our unequivocal support of trans folks and trans kids, especially since they're so extra vulnerable in these situations. So it's like not outside the scope at all. And I really like that idea of, like, also maybe here's some ways to talk to your kids, although I don't know. Well, I'll
certainly at least get Kelda to mention the anti-trans bills and, you know, being opposed to that. Mm-hmm. So, all right, we'll get going in 15 seconds here. All right, it's Motherhood Monday. Our friends from Motherhood for Good join us, Emily Tyne, Erin Phillips, and special guest Senator Kelda Roys. You're a mom. You get to be part of the club too here, right? So you get to be part of Motherhood
Monday. Thanks, it's a great club.
It is, and it's so great to have you all here. Thanks on a Monday morning to talk about things that are they're a little difficult in that we're still trying to get an answer to the seemingly eternal question, honestly, why don't Republicans like childcare? So we're going to work on that, but also a few other matters that the state Senate has been working on this week. So we're so thankful that Kelda Roys is with us. But Emily and Erin, I'm going to start with you folks from a Motherhood for Good standpoint. It has been a major bone of contention that the Child Care Counts program has been lingering like this without Republican support. They've just wanted to kill it entirely. And Governor Evers last week reallocated some unspent pandemic relief funds to keep the program going until early 2025. Erin, what were your own thoughts on hearing the good news side of that equation?
Huge relief. Mm-hmm. Huge relief, you know, and keep on the admiration of Tony Evers, right, who was able to, when faced with, you know, maybe an unsurprising, for those of us who were following the story the whole time, an unsurprising result in terms of Republicans not coming through to support the communities they represent, just massive relief and admiration that Evers was going to come in and protect this, again, at least until 2025, right? I mean, I know that then sets us up for this work to continue, the efforts to continue, but just incredible relief, and I'm just really grateful for him.
Emily, what were your thoughts that while the governor is able to find some funding, you know, that again, the legislature isn't being a partner in this?
I mean, it continues to just boggle my mind, and I look around at my peer group and those that I work with every day, and I want, you know, every day I was just like, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And so similar to what's happening at the federal level, you know, it's like, okay, the government's open one more day, or we have childcare for this amount of time. But I'm still really struggling and hoping to hear from Senator Roys today. What can we continue to do to make sure we don't have to take these steps that, while a relief, like Erin said, really isn't how this should be working, and everybody should be behind this. So how do we get them on board so we can stop with some of these interim steps?
Well, that is the big question there, Senator Roys. And again, there was some speculation early on in the fall session that maybe there'd be some kind of a grand deal on tax cuts here and childcare counts here, and it just seems like Republicans don't have any interest in that. So which is it? Is that they were showing some interest and a deal never came together, or they've just always been opposed to helping support childcare in Wisconsin?
I think it's both. There are just were only a few Republicans who realized what a disaster this was going to be, and that if you don't have reliable, affordable childcare, you're not going to have an economy. But those Republicans are far outnumbered by Republicans who believe we really shouldn't be doing anything to help working families. Senator Knodel made it very, very clear in the hearing that he thinks that if you have kids, you should stay home. And we know who he's talking to, right? He's talking to the moms.
It's not hyperbole. You were posting on social media at the time about the remarks that were being made. And, you know, again, there was no mistaking the meaning.
Right. I mean, he said that I was denigrating his mother, who stayed home to take care of, 8 or 9 kids, by advocating for childcare and talking about how important it was in my own life. And I just think it's outrageous, and it shows how deeply out of touch the Republican Party is. The reality is most families cannot survive on one income in this economy and haven't been able to do so for decades. And there are lots of reasons why parents need to be in the workforce. And it's an economic necessity if we want to have an economy that functions.
So we know about the necessity of it. If we take a step back, just because you've heard so much of the testimony being on joint finance, the Joint Finance Committee yourself, how would you describe the state of childcare today for Wisconsin working families?
I would say it's very, very grim. You know, we have been in a slow-moving crisis for over 20 years in the childcare industry, and that is because it is very expensive to provide childcare and other forms of care work, more so than families can afford. And we've seen this both in terms of the elder care spectrum and early childhood. 4 out of 5 people are no longer working in early childhood education, people with early childhood education degrees. And that's because they can't afford it, because it's poverty wages. But parents really can't afford to pay more. So this is a classic situation where you have something that is a necessity, the market can't provide it, and we need government to step in and close the gap. Just like we discovered with K-12 education, it cannot be the responsibility of parents on their own. And there is a huge societal benefit to making sure that our youngest children, where 90% of brain development is happening, are getting that high quality early childhood education that both enables parents to work and enables those kids to go on and be as successful as possible.
Aaron, would you be able to characterize the typical reaction to folks who are either in Motherhood for Good or sympathetic to the group when they hear the kind of sentiment expressed by Senator Knodel and others that, you know, the need for childcare is a choice and that it's some kind of a luxury that, you know, government shouldn't necessarily support?
Yeah, I mean, I think Senator Roys characterized it perfectly. It's outrageous. It's outraging also. Senator Roys said, it's not always a choice. It's simply a matter of survival for both parents to be working, assuming there are two parents also. You know, in a single parent household, what's the solution here? I mean, I would love for Republicans to have to voice what they think the answer to that is. But again, they've sort of proven to us either by statements like Senator Knodel made or through non-statements that I guess they think it's just that single parent's problem to solve or just two parents' problems to solve. I mean, it is outrageous. And as you can tell, maybe from my response, it's outraging.
I understand that entirely because, again, these are folks who are saying, well, for single moms, you know, and there used to be, you know, AFDC and food stamps and welfare. And there was this mentality of, well, everybody should have to work to get welfare. Well, if you're working, not everybody has, say, a family member, Emily, or a neighbor or somebody to do that. The world we live in now, right now, can't change it, requires good childcare.
Yeah, it requires good childcare, and it requires it to be, you know, such high quality. I was raised by educators. My best friend is an educator, and the people who took care of my daughter during the time she was in a daycare like that are professional and hardworking, and they love our children, and they need a living wage as well, and they need to be able to create a community for our children. So, you know, I was outraged by how they spoke about the people that I drop my child off with every day, who I know go to work and contribute to our society in such a meaningful way. But it's also so disrespectful to the people who take care of our kids every day and are basically told the work you're doing isn't valuable or contributory, and also that their compensation doesn't match that. And so it's insulting on both sides, and the lack of understanding how it fits into the big picture, I just think doesn't compute for the average mom or parent.
Yeah. And we also can't forget, you know, there is another side to this that I don't want to dwell on. But, you know, the reason you want quality childcare that, you know, lives up to certain standards about capacity and safety is, you know, because otherwise you're putting your kids in the hands of people who may not be trustworthy, who may be very bad actors in ways that we don't even want to consider. Senator Roys, there were a few other things that the state Senate worked on last week that would have an impact on women and on families. One was some kind of a funding bill for crisis pregnancy centers. And we talked to Dr. Lyerly about this in the last hour, about how, you know, these so-called crisis pregnancy centers are not what they appear to be. Can you tell us a bit more about the bill? And again, the I wouldn't dare ask you to speak for Republicans, but what is the line of thinking? Why have a bill to support these centers that don't do what they purport to do?
Sure. Well, crisis pregnancy centers are essentially anti-choice disinformation operations. Their goal is to target vulnerable women, oftentimes young women or low-income women. They target communities of color to try to bring them in when they're pregnant and to give them false information. You know, they falsely link abortion to breast cancer or other health risks. They say that abortion can make you infertile. I mean, all these things that are just simply not true. And they do that with the intent to both dissuade women from getting abortions, but also to delay women from actually accessing care. They use deceptive keywords so that if you search for abortion clinic or what are my options during pregnancy, that you'll get shunted to these false clinics. And then they design their logos and they locate themselves in places often next to or adjacent to legitimate healthcare providers that offer abortion services. So these are lying liars whose goal is to force women into continuing their pregnancies. And there were attempts to give them state funding, to give them taxpayer dollars. Now, I think they should be able to operate. I don't think they should be able to deceive people. We need to have consumer protection and address their false advertising, but they should not be funded by taxpayer dollars. And some of these organizations actually funnel young women into evangelical and Christian adoption networks. So they promise them you can have a safe place to live, but you have to give up your baby for adoption. And so the companion bill to this was one that would force the Department of Children and Families to give public grants to organizations that facilitate adoption as well.
What does it say about their financial stewardship for Republicans who are not only willing to give tax dollars to so-called clinics that aren't actual clinics, as well as to all of these voucher schools that consistently do not perform as well as public schools? What does that say about what they're willing to do with our tax dollars?
It says that they are fiscally irresponsible and they want to fund religious conservative movements and organizations. The Republican Party, in a nutshell, they're doubling down on abortion bans. They want to force you to have a child. They're unwilling to provide any postpartum medical care. You know, they don't want to expand Medicaid. They don't want to have any childcare available, but they do want to force you to go to crisis pregnancy centers and say, oh, this is where you can get your medical care, even though they don't have medical professionals on staff. And then we're going to defund public schools so that your children can't get the educational opportunities they deserve, but you can go to a private religious school and we'll drain the public coffers for that purpose. It's incredibly cynical and frankly un-American, and it's, you know, It's what the Republican Party has been doing for decades.
I'm going to ask forgiveness from Aaron and Emily. We've got time for one question, and I've got to get in one other political question while I've got you here, Senator Roys, and that's because Senate Republicans last week, you know, the nice way of putting it is they failed to confirm or turn down the nomination of eight of Governor Evers' appointees. But what it really means is they fired these people for no reason from various positions. And I'm still not sure that there was any kind of a trigger for this, but Senator, how would you characterize what Republican senators did last week to the governor's appointees?
They fired them. And we have to remember that these are citizen volunteers who step forward to serve their community, serving on boards and commissions. There's an OBGYN that heads up the medical examining board. That's the board that keeps us safe from bad doctors. And, you know, they did so basically because he is a good OBGYN and understands that sometimes abortion care is necessary. And that choice should belong to women. They fired a woman who was a survivor of domestic violence simply because they didn't like some of the tweets that she had sent that were political. And, you know, I don't understand why the Republicans think that they're entitled to dictate who the nominees should be to these boards and agencies when they lost the election. Governor Evers is the governor, and he has the right to appoint them. And to have a mass firing like this is, it's totally authoritarian, and it is one reason why Wisconsin's Republican Party is the most authoritarian in the country.
And with that, we have to let it go there. Senator Kelda Roys, Aaron Phillips, Emily Tyne, I appreciate your time so very much. Thank you very much for coming in today. Have a great day, all of you.
Thanks, Pat.
All right. When we come back, Civic Media News Director Terry Bell will join us with three things you should know to start the week. We'll be back. You're up north. All right. Thanks, you guys. So sorry the clock went so fast today.
No, Senator Roys, thank you so much for joining
us. My pleasure. Like, thank you guys for everything you do.
Yeah.
And thank you for all of your content that you put. I mean, it's just, I mean, we like share it all the time, and just thank you for everything you do for the state.
Yeah.
I am at your service, so I really appreciate it.
Sounds great. All right. Y'all have a wonderful day.
Take care, guys.
Thanks, Pat.
Bye. See ya.
Bye.
Hey, Sam, if you're free, if you want to see if Bill is still on the line, I'll take his call right after the break if he's hanging in there.
Yeah, sure. He's still on the line. Terry, did you hop on yet? I got your mic on, but.
There he is.
Hello.
Hello.
Are you on the other? Hang on. Sounds
there
like
he is.
Mic.
Okay. Yep, I got you.
Okay. Very good.
Right. I'm going to take. Oh, wait. You might have your double audio. Yeah, mute yourself on stream.
On the right computer. There. On the.
Right. That's that one. Sorry.
There we go. All right. Are you still there, Terry? Okay. Oh, he probably has to pot you up.
Is that the right mic?
I don't know. Let's find out. Are you
Hello?
There?
Hello?
There we go. Okay. Okay. Good.
Let me talk to Bill quick.
All right. Terry Bell in just a sec with three things to know to start the week. 844-967-2789 is our studio line number. And Bill from Oconomowoc wants to join us for a quick word on our last segment. Bill, good morning. What's on your mind?
Good morning. Well, you guys are really the lighthouse for reality in a murky world of politics. The ladies that were on just a minute ago, the main problem with the biggest problem with conservatives and the far right, they have no concept of humanitarianism. They don't care to help their fellow man, their fellow care to help build the cities. They have no interest in infrastructure. It's plain as can be. They actually can't comprehend on an intelligent level our eyes, but not in reality. Okay. So when it comes to these mothers and women that need help, my God, people, wake up. You know, it's not about getting tax cuts for the people that support you only because that's all you care about. It's a lot more to that. And I think they got to be called out. And I don't mean just at the voting booth. They got to be called out in public. They got to be called out of the media. They got to be challenged to defend a right that has nothing to do with democracy. Thanks so much for what you do and have a great day.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Nice way to start to wrap things up for this Monday morning. Terry Bell joins us now from the Civic Media Newsroom to talk about three things you should know to start the week. Terry, how's your weekend?
It was really good weekend, Pat. How was yours?
It was good, although I didn't see it, but I kind of, from reading up on it, I could feel the heartache from the volleyball loss to Nebraska.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people talked about the Badger football big win and the Packers disappointing loss, but oh my gosh, that volleyball match was, it lived up to all the hype. It was a battle of titans that went down the wire. The Nebraska Cornhuskers won by the smallest of possible margins you can in a volleyball match. And it all came down to really not any a spectacular play, but because of a net foul, a net violation. Wow. that the Badgers committed, that the Huskers got on a video replay, a second look at it. So, yeah, I mean, boy, you know, we both know sports is designed to break your heart at yes. times. And that certainly was the case Saturday night.
It did, but it you know, it's being referred to as an instant classic, and I'm sure for good reason. Want to bring up one caller in on the text line here saying, please point out that State Senator Romaine Quinn from up here in Northwest Wisconsin is one of the people pushing state funding for these groups. I believe that Tony here is talking about the crisis pregnancy centers and others, and that he can be defeated in his reelection. Well, the fact of the matter is the whole legislature might be up for grabs if depending on how that redistricting case goes in the state Supreme Court, something that Terry and I are definitely following. But in terms of three things to know to start the week, let's kind of reset things into Israel, its war against Hamas. And, you know, things could be perilous for the U.S. in this situation.
Well, exactly. The U.S. Already committed to supporting Israel, but could get drawn in more if American personnel in that part of the world become targets. And that's what Secretary of State Anthony Blinken promised on the Sunday talk shows yesterday. Things are definitely escalating. Israeli warplanes are striking targets in Gaza, including places where civilians have been told to seek refuge. So it's getting uglier and uglier all the time. Israel apparently laying the groundwork for a ground invasion.
And one thing to keep in mind, and I did hear somebody with Hezbollah referred to this last week. Today is the anniversary of the bombing of the Marine barracks in Lebanon on this day in 1983, killing 241 U.S. military personnel and leading the Reagan administration to pull U.S. troops out of Lebanon during that Civil War period. So anything that happens there is, forgive the cliche, but fraught with peril for mm-hmm. for the United States. And it's something that we need to keep in mind. It doesn't mean you don't get involved, but that you understand the risks and the dangers. Unfortunately, not much can happen on the front from the congressional standpoint while the House of Representatives is still deadlocked. Is there any change in the tote board? I feel like the number of candidates for Speaker of the House is changing by the hour here.
Nine by my last count. What's yours? Wow.
No, nine is, no, I had 7-9. It's, yeah, nine sounds about right now. Just crazy.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. So after Jim Jordan stepped aside, I don't know if he stepped aside so much as he was asked to step aside, but he's out of the race now, and they opened it up to applications. Nine people. I don't know if we have time to list them all. Oh,
probably not. I said that my if I had to lay a dollar down, it would probably be Tom Emmer from Minnesota. But again, who knows? I mean, we don't even know for sure how they're going to go about picking from amongst these folks, you know?
Apparently they're going to be vetted today. Somehow there's going to be a kind of a forum happening today and a vote maybe as early as tomorrow. And apparently everyone has agreed to a unity pledge that whoever emerges out of this will get a vote on the floor. So there's that. I have a feeling none of these nine names are household names.
No, none of them. That's why I thought we don't even have to bother. None of them are. So, yeah. which may actually work in some favor that, you know, rather than going the celebrity route is maybe they just pick a good caretaker, you know, to get them through the next few months here through the rest of the session.
I'm kind of reminded when there was some tumult in the speakers and the Republicans eventually landed on Dennis Hastert. Nobody had heard of him. So I'm thinking it's going to be somebody. Well, you know, his problems notwithstanding.
Maybe, yeah, without the criminal baggage, you know, maybe down the road.
Somebody who has, at least at the present, seems like a safe compromise that everyone can live with.
One more thing you should know is that the Taylor Swift Eras concert tour is over, and yet she is still making a killing revenue-wise. This time, not with the live shows, but the theater shows.
Yeah, the amazing thing is happening in movie theaters, and that's why I listed it as one of the three things to know is because this movie, this concert film is really doing wonders for movie houses, which were in peril during the pandemic and kind of struggled on its way back. But after the Barbieheimer phenomenon this summer, we may have part two, because not only is the Eras Tour concert film doing quite well, but so is Martin Scorsese's new epic, Killers of the Flower Moon. So I think it's encouraging, and I'm editorializing here, but it's good that theaters still have a place in entertainment. At home, our situations for taking in media at home are better than ever, granted. But I still think people want a night out. They want to gather. They want a shared experience. And these two films, and going back to Barbieheimer this summer, you know, people want to congregate and enjoy something together.
You know, and so that's the lesson. Make good stuff. Give good content, whether it's a concert or well-written movie, whatever the case may be. Terry, thanks so much. Have a great day.
Thank you, Pat.
All right. New lineup starting today. Earl Ingram is next across most of these civic media stations, although you'll still have Chad Holmes in Wausau, Stephanie Miller in Madison, James Jay in Wisconsin Rapids. They're all followed by As Goes Wisconsin. Then Todd Alba moves to noon to 2, Matt Flynn from 2 to 4, and the Devil's Advocates from 4 to 6. I'm Pat Kreitler. We'll still be here 6 to 8 tomorrow morning. Enjoy your Monday. We'll see you tomorrow.